live from Estopan All In. It's the Vamos Morados podcast,
powered by the state of Louisville.
Welcome to the Vamos Morados podcast on the State of Louisville Podcast Network. I'm your host, Zach.
And I'm Benton.
And Benton, we are joined by a pretty awesome guest this week. We have writer, podcaster, radio broadcaster, and communications director for Racing Louisville, Jeff Greer, with us. Jeff, how are you doing?
I'm wonderful. I'm excited to be joining you fellas. It's been a long time, and I'm so sorry that we've kind of lost our pickup soccer days a little bit as we've added more responsibility to our lives, but it's great to be chatting with you.
I know. Even I haven't made it out to the pickup game in several weeks.
Brutal.
Yeah, we're slacking, but I'm excited to pick your brain and talk about racing. But before we get into that, we got other stuff we want to go over. So Zach, what are you into this week?
Been this week, I am back into pinball. So before our daughter was born, I was playing a lot of pinball, like in tournaments and stuff. That was like the hobby I dropped when we had the daughter, because that was the thing I could no longer make time for. But I had my birthday was over the weekend, and so my wife. Thank you. My wife took me out to Rec Bar for my birthday. I got to play a bunch of pinball, and it was a blast. There were a bunch of new machines since last time I played. I really enjoyed Big Lebowski pinball they had there, which was pretty great. It was nice to pick it back up a little bit.
I want to go back. I'm fascinated about the pinball tournament concept. What do you guys just like get like one round and like high scores like win or?
They play like round robin format. So you get in groups of four and you play a four player game, and then you get points for how you finish in the group. So first place gets like 7 points. Second place gets five. Third place gets three. And then last place gets one. And usually you play a couple rounds of that. And then whoever like top half of the field points wise goes on to like a single elimination tournament.
It's like the World Cup sort of set up pretty much.
Yeah. Yeah. They used to, they still do, but Zanzibar has like a monthly tournament. It's pretty cool. There's like it's IFPA. I forgot the abbreviation, but there's actually like a sanctioning organization that you get ranking points from playing. And there's like a state championship that you can qualify for if you get enough points. I think back when I was actually playing like a tournament a month, I just narrowly missed making the state championship. So
I'd never thought of it like in that sort of format. That's just really fascinating that world exists. I'm pretty trash at pinball, so I wouldn't be any good at it. I think most of my experience came like on, you know, like back on Windows XP, they had like the Space Cadet pinball
on the computers.
Played it like middle school and like high school on the computers there. Yeah, that's what I think of with pinball. But so what I'm into this week is been getting back into reading my graphic novels a bit. I got a bunch, start reading some, and then life happened and I'm just now getting back into that. And it's been fun kind of mixing it up because of my unhealthy video game playing habit that I've recently found myself in. That's how I'm breaking things up. I'm still playing Dota a lot and it's really bad. Don't play it if you've never played it before.
Are we just going to, is what has been into this week just going to be Dota for the rest of the season?
It still is. They just released a new patch. It's a whole new game. It's such a time sink. Hole. The game's so toxic. It's such a steep learning curve, but I can't stop.
Well, I got a decent graphic novel library if you're looking for some books. You can always borrow one.
I might have to do that. I got a little pile here I got to get through first, but then I'm probably going to hit you up.
Jeff, I know you're a pretty busy guy. Have you been into anything? You watching any good TV shows?
Well, it's funny. Which day, first of all, which day is your actual birthday?
The 23rd.
23rd. Okay. So I'm the 20th. So I spent all day of my birthday flying to Portland, Oregon. So that was fun.
There are worse places to spend a birthday.
That's true. There are worse places. There are better places also.
I like Portland.
They have a lot of great coffee. I can see the redeeming parts of the city, but In fairness to Portland, and I'm guessing people who would stay in any city might say this, but they're really struggling downtown. And as a result, it's not a great place to be staying for 4 days. I'll leave it at that. But they have great coffee, great beer. I enjoyed every meal I had. I had incredible Thai food. But what I'm into, okay, I actually came prepared. If you had me like 3 or 4 days ago, I would have been like, I'm into changing diapers. But instead, I actually have something that I just recently watched for the first time. On the flight back, we played, Racing played on Saturday night. We got back to the hotel. The hotel Wi-Fi was incredibly slow. I don't know if people fully understand the cadence of our jobs, but I was not in bed until about 2:30. We got up at about 4:30 to go to the airport, and then flew back. Now, normal people who don't have 15-month-year-olds, I can't talk, 15-month-olds who don't sleep.
15-month-old will do that.
Yeah. Normal people would have probably napped on the first flight to Dallas. I did not. I had a cup of coffee and I got started with my day. And I watched A Star Was Born. I had never seen that movie. I'd heard a lot of, about it.
Watch the new one or the, I think there's three of them, weren't there?
I watched the 2018 one. Okay. I did not watch the 1937 one. Although I now am intrigued by the whole story in general, but I gotta say, what a film. To go on the Wikipedia page and start clicking around into some interviews. Once I really like something, I'd do that. To learn that Lady Gaga's dad in that movie is Andrew Dice Clay, like, blew my mind. I will tell you this. I'm hoping that she didn't notice me, but in my row, as I'm like, you know, kind of like trying to dampen my tears as my dog is joining the conversation, dampen my tears and just trying to keep it together on this 4-hour flight to Dallas, however long it was. I looked over to my right and Abby Erceg just happened to also be looking back in my direction. I'm hoping that she did not notice that I was quietly weeping at 9 a.m. to A Star Is Born.
Never let Abby see you cry.
No, you can't let her see any fear. She'll take advantage.
She could have just assumed it was the sleep deprivation kicking in.
That's accurate. That's true.
So Benton, I don't want to spend a ton of time on this one. I feel like we gotta touch on the Louisville City game. And then while we have Jeff, I think we should spend most of our time on racing this week. Is that good?
Yeah, I agree. And I think every year you get just a small handful of games that are just really like, there's not a ton to them. And unfortunately, this Charleston one was one of those matches. And I mean, yeah, it was a big matchup, like on paper, when you're looking at the standings, how good the teams are. But when it comes to like on-field stuff, like it was not the most exciting match in the world. We got a point from it. Like, I'm satisfied. Maybe Charleston. Yeah, maybe Charleston had the slight edge compared to us in that one. But I mean, that maybe that's splitting hairs a bit.
It's never a good sign when you look up the package after the game and it just completely skips the first half. I think the first highlight is like the first half ending.
So I think to your point, like the first half was like pretty much nothing happened, but I did notice like the data wasn't correct on all those matches. There were a couple shots made in that first half, but they weren't registered in any like the stats platform or whatnot. But, and I don't know if the video portion of that feeds into that, but I mean, to your point, yeah, it was the second half was where all the action was and wasn't a ton. I think that one of the most awkward sequences was when Semmel came out of the box on that one. You know which one sequence I'm talking about?
I was
scary.
I made a note. So he has been really good. I think he was actually probably my player of the game for that game. Yeah. But there have been a couple times this season where something similar to that has happened, where he's gotten stuck like way outside the box and it's gotten sketchy a few times. He does seem to like it with as good of a season as he's had. He does have a habit of maybe coming out a little too far a couple times.
Yeah. I mean, I had him as my man of the match as well. And that was like the one like knock against him on that was an awkward sequence. Thankfully somebody got a deflection on the ball. I don't recall who it was that kind of prevented the chip from happening, but yeah, ultimately, I think they had a few better looks than we did, but the XGs were incredibly low for both sides. It was very, just a very tactical kind of chess match sort of game. And nobody really like jumped off the page to make a difference really on either side of the ball. And so we were left with a nil-nil draw. When you're on the road against a team like that, though, like you're not going to be too mad about that result.
I think we knew it was going to be a defensive struggle coming into that. Charleston has had a very good defense. I think Ben Pierman, his teams have always had good defenses. So I think, yeah, getting a draw away against a team like that, like you take your points, move on to the next game.
Yeah, I'm not going to say it's one of those draws that felt like a win, but from their perspective, it might have kind of felt like a little bit of a loss. They probably won it more than a point at home on that, but such is the game. Still a lot of season left. It's just unfortunate that we couldn't get all 3 points and take the lead on top of the table, but it's still pretty close and things can swing pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Not too worried about it.
Pack up and move on to the big matchup, which will probably already have happened by the time this episode posts. So we had to do too much of a preview, but we got the Open Cup match midweek this week against Cincy.
Yeah, I'm super excited about that one. Very curious what the lineup is going to look like, considering that we play Memphis on the weekend, and then you know the match that we had just played. Wes Sharpie made his first appearance on the bench, so I'm kind of curious if he's going to get some minutes in the Cincinnati match. If not that one, maybe Memphis. It seems like a good time for him to maybe kind of get swapped in there. I don't know, you know, about how Tosh or Josh are doing, but I imagine cycling one of them out at some point wouldn't be the worst idea in the world.
Very, very happy to see him get some minutes, because I think the back line has been struggling with some depth issues, and having all these road games and a midweek game really could use all the depth we can get on the back line.
Yeah, that was one particular position of concern. I mean, when you're talking about midfield and some of these forward positions, I feel like we have plenty of guys, but those are the kind of real tough spots that I think we've struggled with depth wise. And it just sucked that Wes had been out and then Jordan Scarlett was out. And, you know, whenever Widener was gone, it's just started to become slim pick and started to get a little area of concern, but so it'll be really interesting to see how these lineups go. You know, just hoping we have a good match against Cincinnati. Hopefully by the time you're listening to this, we're maybe it's the time for the next round of the draw and that we're in that.
Yeah. Hopefully we're still in the Open Cup by the time this episode posts.
Yeah, that's my hope. And then move on to Memphis. They're not the team that they were last year. So, I mean, I'm not looking past them, but at the same time, like, it's not the same level of concern that last season we would have put towards them. I think Ben Pierman really was a difference maker there, and they don't have that this year. To their credit, I think they've had a little bit of a tough start to the season, but still, we'll see. I think we're playing at their AutoZone Park, and that's a pretty weird place to play too.
That Memphis game probably gives the team a little more flexibility with the lineups for the midweek Open Cup game. I think you probably can rotate a couple more players for that game than you would if it were a different team they're playing that next weekend. So I think that works out in Louisville's favor.
Yeah. So we'll see how those pan out. Be really curious. See how that looks, but let's move on. Let's talk about Racing. Jeff, I want to get you into this. I want to pepper you with questions, but before we do that, let's talk about that Portland match.
Okay.
That you're at. So I guess just, you want to kick us off? What were kind of your general thoughts about that?
What match? Were the vibes? How'd that go?
Well, I could go in a variety of directions with it. I would say, you know, first of all, as much as I just disparaged Portland, it is a really awesome soccer place. And their fans show up and they're loud. And they know when to clap, which is something that really, I appreciate. It was something I learned as a really, really young kid, in England. I was like 11 or 12 years old. We went to a Coventry City match and people were clapping at like someone executing a nice sliding challenge. And I was like, okay, this is kind of cool. So in Portland, if somebody makes a good play, doesn't have to be a goal or an assist or a save. It can be anything. In between the boxes as well, people know to cheer and stuff, and they've got their whole game day experience down. It's really well done. So that was fun. As far as the actual match goes, I mean, look, I think Portland is the best team in the league. I think they are the deepest team in the league. So the fact that they played us, it was what, their third game in 8 days. They played us after playing San Diego, and I think they went to San Diego and then came back for the Racing match. That's a lot. That's a lot for them. So I think, you know, they're so good in transition that that's what racing wants to be eventually and get to. And for the first time in the franchise's very young history, I feel like we have the players who are capable of getting us there. I think there's a couple up the sleeve. Once you get Tembi Katlana back, once you get Amina Ekic back, I think people have kind of forgotten that those players exist while they're out. It's easy to forget. I think the biggest takeaway is, man, Sophia Smith is really good. I've been really impressed with Rebecca Holloway being kind of thrown into a center back role and has stepped in there and played pretty well, I think, and dealt with some of the best players in the league in the first four games. Love Ari Borges. And then I think the biggest thing for me is the players are mad when they lost. Like, they were mad. They were upset that they lost, and they felt like they played well enough, especially after the initial kind of surge from Portland. They played well enough through the first half to feel like they were in the game. To give up that goal right before halftime was frustrating. But to see them be mad, not that they weren't last year, but it was just like a different upset last year. It was like more of a frustration. This year, it's like, this team thinks they should be getting points in every game. And that's an adopted mentality that you get with some of the players they've added, as well as some of the players having a year of experience. So, like I said, a lot of different directions I always come back from road trips with, but I still feel really good about this team and think they are a team that is very much going to be a playoff contender this year.
Yeah. You mentioned it a little bit, but Holloway, I mean, we have not been super big on her at center back on the podcast, but I have to say that is such a tough position that she got thrown into, having to check into a game that early. Cause I think, you know, you start on the bench, you warm up, you're kind of expecting like, maybe I'll check in the second half. Maybe you're sort of adjusting your expectations for that. And then to have to check in 2 minutes into the game like that, I mean, that just has to completely reset your internal clock. So I think she actually played a very good game, for especially considering the circumstances she had to come in.
Yeah. Credit where credit's due, you know. Won't slate her for that one, but ultimately, like, I know that Julie Lester, correct me if I'm wrong, she's injured, right? She's out of the equation currently.
She is back in training and has been on the subs bench the last two games, but has not come in yet. I don't think she would be on the subs bench if she wasn't close to being, they weren't close to being comfortable to put her in. So I would expect to see her sooner rather than later for sure.
Okay. I overlooked her inclusion. I know at least earlier on, I think she was dealing with an injury. And then Satara Murray, I think she's been healthy there. I mean, do you think that Holloway is the better option of those three?
It's tough to say. I mean, because, you know, Julia Lester played a lot last year at the end of the year at right back. I really like her at outside back, but she's more defensively oriented than Lauren Millay. So you kind of have to pick and choose what you want. I think from watching the games, it's clear that Kim Bjorkegren wants his outside backs to get high, to get really high and almost make it look like a kind of like a 2-1-7, with the amount of attacking bodies that they have forward. I think they have I'll leave it at this. I think they have a nice array of options because none of those players are similar. I think Julia Lester is someone who has long been a center back, who can play right back. I think Satara Murray is a center back who I thought played pretty well at the end of last year and is competing for time there. And then I think Rebecca Holloway is almost like a left winger who has had a chance to play a little bit of a different role right now and showing off her speed. So yeah, I think they all have options. And I think once you throw Holloway in there and she plays well, you keep her in your lineup. And then like we just saw with Ellie Pikuyamsa coming back into central defense with the midfield getting set again, it's like, okay, great. You have Rebecca Holloway off the bench. And as Zach said, she was immediately called into action. I wouldn't have been surprised if she got subbed in at some point in the game based on those first three. But yeah, she ended up playing the whole shebang. And once again, I thought has acquitted herself pretty well.
Yeah, that's fair. I'll trust the process as far as the player selection goes. And maybe one day I'll eat my words about not being the biggest Rebecca Holloway fan, at least her playing a center back over the other options. I'm sorry, Zach, you were going to say something.
Have we gotten word on Pikiyamsa after coming out of that game? It looked like she pulled up with some sort of like muscle pull in her leg. But I have not, I should have done my homework. I have not seen if there's been any further word on that.
No, it was a muscle, but we don't know what the extent is. I know, you know, traveling back certainly makes it a little bit more difficult. The players had obviously Sunday was a travel day, and then they've had Monday and today. We're recording this on Tuesday off, so I don't know if they've done any X-rays or done anything yet to figure that out. But yeah, it sucks because she was one of our best players in preseason. I went to pretty much every scrimmage that they played, exhibition, a lot of training, and I was really impressed with her. And I know that showed in games. And then to have that happen after a giveaway too, that I know she was really frustrated about, it stinks. So hopefully it's not long-term.
She's been a real like pleasant surprise for me. Not that I doubted her or anything. I just didn't know what to expect. I think she's just, I don't know, wherever I had her mentally pegged, she was above that and kind of really showed some exciting play and really, really good player. So yeah, I hope we don't lose her for a very long time. Hopefully it's just like a little minor thing, you know, game or two situation. As far as the Portland match goes, I liked to hear that they were upset about the loss, and like, not like in any sort of negative way, but like, you can feel that the bar is being raised. Like, we know we have the talent, the skill, the ability. And so for us to lose that, for them to be upset about it in the way that you were describing versus like, oh, you know, like it's Portland, what are you going to do? I like the direction that the team's mentality is. And I'm of the mindset, and maybe you can chime in here, is that the more that these players are going to get to play together, the better they're going to be, because right now we still have a lot of new players that have only played a couple of competitive matches with one another. So there's still kind of a lot of that chemistry still to be built. Like, might look good still on the pitch, but I think that they can still take it an extra step further, and that can make a real world of a difference. Is that kind of a fair observation?
I think so. When we were in Portland for the preseason tournament, you kind of got a glimpse of, and again, you know, I think, and I've tried to make sure that I check myself on this, is like, they played Portland the first game, played them pretty square all the way through, gave up kind of a scrap goal at the end of the game. It was kind of a uncleared corner that ended up just getting poked in. And then dominated OL Reign for 70 minutes. But OL Reign, in fairness, that was probably the type of lineup you're going to see in the Challenge Cup when their players are away from the World Cup. Now, that being said, Racing also is going to have a pretty similar lineup during that run, with the exception of Wang Shuang and Ari Borges. You're going to have mostly the same team out there, which I think is an advantage. But in that first half against OL Reign, and then especially the first half against the U.S. under 23s, which again, I know competition wise is a step down from what we're used to seeing Racing play. I got to really see, like, when they're flowing and they're getting forward, and you've got Savannah DeMello, you've got Wang Shuang, you've got Carson Pickett, who can unlock a lot with her passing. Ellie Pikiyamsa is a really good long range passer. I think Jalen Howell is a very good unlocking passer as well, to get things in transition. But when you've got the options that Racing has, and the pace that Racing has, with some of the players who I'm just anxious to let them get going, and Tembi Katlana and Uchenna Kanu, especially, I think they're, like you said, I mean, I think that level that they reach where they, you know, they start winning games and stuff is going to come when they're starting to score goals in transition. And that's where it's like, you go from being a fun team that can score on set pieces and maybe get some long range goals like they have, to a team that gets out in transition and scores too, and takes some of the chances that they haven't taken just yet. Not just because for a variety of reasons in these first four games, but also because they're not fully healthy. So I totally agree. There is absolutely another level for this team to hit. And the fact that they are still very much looking like a team that is going to be hard to beat all year before reaching that level gives me a lot of hope for what the potential is for this group.
Yeah, I feel like we've seen in the first couple games, we've seen glimpses of the team they're going to be. I think they've had stretches in games, especially like the first half of that Los Angeles game. They've had bits and pieces. They've just so far not been able to put that together for like a full 90 minutes. Mm-hmm. And I think getting some players back healthy and getting some more time with each other when they're starting to be able to keep that up for a full 90, I think they're going to be really dangerous.
Yeah. I'm thinking of there's a sequence in the first 15 minutes of that Angel City match. I think it was Howell from about midfield sent it off to Kayla Fisher, who got over to Davis. And then I think it was DeMello got the shot at, and ultimately ended up hitting off the post. But man, that was liquid football right there. That was beautiful. That was like the glimpse of the kind of thing this team can be. And if they can string sequences like that together with regularity, they are going to be a lot of fun to watch, and they're going to start winning a lot of games.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's where like today's trade for Jordan Baggett, I think will really help. We talk about Angel City. Everyone in that locker room is still pissed that game was not 3 points. And not in a way that it's lingering and, you know, I know people get worried that like one loss leads to, or one draw, I guess in that case, leads to a bunch of bad results. It's not in that way, but I think everyone looks at that game and says that first half is how Racing wants to play all the time. And we even saw glimpses of that style and that flowing fun style against Portland. I mean, there were a couple of times where Racing like got out and looked like a team that could score goals against the best teams in the league. And it's just, you bring in a player like Baggett, you get Julia Lester healthy, and you start to see players who can help you ice a game. You need to be able to keep possession. You need to be able to control the midfield a little bit better. And more importantly, you need people who can help your team not consistently shift back into a lower and lower block when they're under pressure. You need to be able to kind of build away from pressure. As you guys know, my club team in the Premier League is Leeds, and they basically took a lead today, for instance, and were just under pressure for the rest of the game pretty much, and just could not really get out of that low block. And I think that's the next step for a team that wants to be a playoff contender, is learning how to control games a little bit better and play with a lead.
Outside of that really unfortunate start to the game, I'm not happy losing 2-0 ever, but I think that the team really did settle in sort of the middle of that game a little mm-hmm. bit and was playing with Portland and I thought looked really good, and just had a couple of sequences at the start and at the end of that first half where, you know, minus those two sequences, I thought that was actually a pretty even game. And compared to how the team has played against Portland previously is a big improvement.
Yeah, I mean, I know the team's upset about that loss, and I'm glad that they are. But with that said, I do give them a bit of grace that it was, you know, that was Portland that we're losing to. I mean, it's a very quality side. So like, if you're going to lose to somebody like them, like, makes it a little bit more digestible and understandable. But
really, I would like really to get points off there. Of them at some point in the team's history, though.
I agree with you on that one, but
the sixth time is the charm. The sixth time
is the charm. There we go.
Thing.
The set pieces looked really nice. That I think that's probably for me one of the biggest areas of improvement I've seen year over year. I think in Portland, they had a couple really good set piece looks. I think that was a huge, huge problem for the team the first two seasons. And that appears to, I mean, have completely turned around so far this year. So Erzig especially has been a huge asset to have on set pieces. The team has sort of lacked a really good target before this season. I think she has been a big help there.
You have world-class delivery too. I mean, you've got Savannah DeMello, you have Carson Pickett, you have Wang Shuang, you have Ari Borges. And, you know, I do think that they may have tried to to sneak in at the Olympico that RA had for Brazil. It looked like they may have tried to sneak that in at one point. I think it got blocked or it just didn't go off. But yeah, I agree. You throw in Ellie when Ellie's healthy, Ellie Pikuyamsa, she scored a really nice back post header off a recycled corner. I think it was against the U23s. Kayla Fisher is good in the air. So, I mean, really strong and required a save from Bixby on the one header she had the other day. So that's something that, you know, in my position, I get to make to give a shout out where people might not know, but that's a Serge Gonzalez. Sergio Gonzalez has worked really hard on set pieces and deserves a lot of credit for that because he's got some toys to play with this team and has done a nice job. So the set plays aspect of this team has kept them in games as we've seen or helped them fight back. And I think it's something that as you grow as a team and you go from you play poorly or you don't play great, you still get a draw out of a game. And then when you play average to good, you can win a lot of games. Set pieces can be the thing that salvage games for teams when they're not playing well. And to be able to execute those is a big plus for sure.
Yeah. I'm looking through this, through the stats of this match here. And the more I look at it, the more like we did, I mean, it was pretty decent. Like I would have liked less shots again. So we let up total 20 shots against, 6 on target. Would have liked a little bit less there, but I mean, we put up 12 shots of our own, 4 on target. Passing, a lot of passes, high on pass rate. And that was one thing I was particularly not happy with last season is that we had trouble stringing together passes. And if you look at those little passing radar maps, I think it's, what's her name? Ariel Dor on Twitter.
Yeah.
She puts out those visualizations of the passing maps. Like you're starting to see much more of a web there, which is what you're wanting to see. So the more I think about this match, the more like I'm happy with what things that we saw there. But obviously still knowing that there's obviously room for improvement because, you know, we didn't win, but we didn't get any points from that match, but still a lot of good takeaways from that one.
How about we throw to some ads and then let's come back and ask some questions about Jeff. Get to know Jeff a little better.
Let's do it. Catch you guys on the other side.
Does this ever happen to you? Do you ever get sick of listening to the same old sports radio? Mount Rushmore this, hot seat that, the same rehashed old musty takes you've been hearing for years. Does it send you into a fit of rage, causing you to lose control of the steering wheel, crashing into a vehicle leading to you being late to a big meeting at work, which leads to your ultimate firing and downward spiral of your life? Does this ever happen to you? Don't send your life into a downward spiral. Do what thousands of others are already doing, listening to the State of Louisville Podcast Network. Louisville football, basketball, women's basketball, baseball, Louisville City and Racing Louisville soccer, Louisville culture, and so much more. State of Louisville Podcast Network and stateoflouisville.com. Real fans' opinions for real fans like you.
And welcome back to the Vamos Marauders podcast. My name's Benton.
I'm Zach.
And we are about to grill Jeff Greer. I want to hear all about your life, Jeff. What's going on with you? So first off, for the people not familiar with you, can you just kind of give us your little elevator speech on who you are and how you got into your current role with the organization?
Oh, wow. I had to do this the other day to Abby, speaking of Abby or Seg, so I'll do it here too.
We're a little less intimidating.
Yeah, she's awesome. She's so cool. I long story short, thought like many other people that I would be some kind of college athlete, stopped growing in ninth grade, and just started pulling muscles and having injuries and just it all went to crap. I went to school, studied sports journalism, and my goal, at least at that point in my life, around 21, 22, was to be a national college basketball reporter. And I worked really, really hard over about 13 years to get to The Athletic. I was at the Courier Journal. I worked nights at the Washington Post. I worked at US News and World Report and a couple other places. So I got to that point and I kind of found myself wondering, like, is this it? Like, is there something else that I could be doing? And that's when my wife and I decided to step back from everything and go to Europe. We were supposed to be there for a year. We got 5 months in and then the pandemic hit. I am still just absolutely crushed that my assignment, I had a Washington Post 5-story assignment at the Euros in Munich, where the group was Portugal, France, Germany, and Hungary. And I had like features on Mbappe and Ronaldo that I was going to be assigned, that I had been assigned. And obviously that did not happen. So came back to the US and at that point kind of had a chance to reevaluate everything. And that was right when Racing Louisville was announced. What was that, like the fall of 2020, guys? That was like things really started to pick up to get ready for the 2021 season. And yeah, I've just always loved women's soccer in particular, getting to root for the US national team and all that stuff for 20 something years. But I've also been a huge Leeds guy since like 1998. So it was a natural transition to shift into communications role for the team and get a chance to work with the Louisville City guys and obviously get a chance to work with Racing, which is super fun.
Now that you're on the inside, how has your perspective changes? And do you still like love the game and like love being involved with the team? Or does the fact that it's become your work kind of muddy the waters for you as far enjoyment wise, like from watching?
I'm a pretty joyful person when it comes to sports. I, you know, my friends in the sports writing world got to a point where a lot of them who I care about deeply and I'm still really good friends with a lot of them, almost are like jaded about, like, you go to the Final Four and they're just like, yeah, it's another game. I'm like, it's the Final Four. Like, this is awesome. We should be excited about this. So no, I probably care too much. I hate sitting alone in a press box like I did on Saturday because I had no one to like nudge when something exciting was happening. So no, I live and die with Racing. Of course, I'm professional about it. And you probably can't see it when you're sitting in the press box next to me, but no, I live and die with this team and city too. I mean, it's difficult not to when you're around these people every day. But I'll tell you, Benton, the biggest thing that is different for me is I don't think people realize all of the interpersonal things that go on like in any office, there's just a lot of relationships things and like, there's more drama, not like bad drama that ends up to the level of obviously things that have happened in the past. We're not going to act like that didn't exist or happen, but just little day-to-day things that you just don't think about when you're not in that environment. Helping someone get a car, helping someone get their visa squared away, helping someone get their travel set up for international duty, helping someone get their dog into the United States. Like all of these little things that I don't think people realize have just made it so much more interesting to me to be inside the wall. So I really love it. And I love the whole group that we have that we get to work with. So it's been really fun. It's been really fun.
I think people a lot of times with athletes forget that they are people and they have jobs. It's jobs like everyone else has. And so, you know, outside of 90 minutes a week that they're playing a game, for most of their week, like they have a job and they have to deal with coworkers and live lives like regular people do. So I think that's the side of it a lot of people lose sight of as sports fans a lot of times, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's basically what I was going to say. It's like we just have this 90-minute glimpse of them playing the game, and there's just so much stuff surrounding that. And I guess it's like, Jeff, you and a lot of other people's jobs to help try to make their lives as simple as possible so they can focus on those 90, well, not only just those 90 minutes, but their trainings and all the things that they need to do for their bodies. I mean, being a professional athlete is essentially it's a 24-hour job, you know, when you're talking about nutrition and training and putting in all that work to get those end results.
Yeah. Well, I'll give you a couple examples. Like we had, just one player, for example, we were supposed to have a couple of them come to an event a few weeks ago. And the week of, it was just kind of like, I don't know if I can be on my feet that much the day before we play a game. I really need to play well this week. I haven't been playing well. And you just don't really think about that. You're just kind of like, well, you can just come sit at this event and you'll be fine. And they're like, no, my headspace, I need to focus on this. Because there's a lot of pressure and there's a, you know, something else that happened, when we were in Oregon, for the preseason, for the Portland tournament in the preseason, you know, I had a couple of players come up to me and say, like, people are DMing me, like asking me if I'm okay and stuff like that. And they're just like, we're fine. We're doing great. Like, we're doing great. We're trying to focus on our jobs. And, you know, I think that's, it just goes back to like, there's a lot of people who care. And are worried or concerned or excited or living and breathing with everything that's happening in terms of games or whatever it is. But that's a lot to weigh on 26 shoulders or 26 pairs of shoulders and the coaching staff. And to Zach's point, they still like have to wake up and walk their dogs. And then they come and they go home at, you know, 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock and they have to make sure they're taking care of their bodies. Right. But they, other things that they like to do all across the spectrum of the world. And it's fascinating. And the cool part for me is our team is cool. Like, they're nice people, they're nice human beings. And I think that makes a big difference to be able to ask them to do stuff and they're like totally fine with it. But like Zach said, and you as well, Benton, like, it's our job to make sure that they're feeling cared for, that they're feeling supported, and that we're taking care of the little things so that they feel like they're in the best position to be able to execute those jobs, to live up to all of those expectations that are being placed on them.
You mentioned players getting DMs in the preseason. A dynamic that I have thought has had to be very strange for the players, like this past, this season, end of last season, is because there was such a gap between, I guess, when things happened with the team and when things came public, that the fan base and the players were in two completely different places just in time with that. I feel like something that was very, very fresh for a lot of the fan base, because they had just found out about it, was something that had happened like a year in the past for a lot of the players. And so it has, on top of everything else, it has to have been very weird just feeling like you're out of time with the public on things.
Yeah. Well, one thing I want to say, and I know that we've talked about this, I don't want to say offline because we all talk online, but I know the three of us have talked a lot about this and with a couple of our other friends too, but something that was really important to me, and I hope you guys have been around me enough to know that, like, I try to be a pretty good guy, we have got a really good staff, and you know, I'll give Benton's pal Jeff Milby a shout out. His wife Caitlin is like a magician running the show as the ops director for racing, but her and me, Logan Agan, our social media admin, who also works in comms, worked really, really, really hard with every department in our building to make sure that we had things lined up for players when they came back, but that we were in constant communication with them, you know, through the entire off season to check in on people, to make sure things are going okay. And that's where Ryan Dell is going to really help us too, as a GM, to come in and kind of be the organizer of everything. But we worked so, so hard so that our players, like you said, Zach, all this stuff came public. It was awful. A lot of us hated seeing the details of it. A lot of us didn't work here 2021. I didn't. And I know it was painful for the players to relive it. But I think what was more important for us, at least, was give it a chance, give everyone a chance to absorb. But let's get to work on making sure that we are in a place that something like that never even remotely is even on the radar here in the future. So again, they can focus on feeling cared for and supported and go do their jobs and play the sport that they love. Cause they really do absolutely love soccer. Like, they're obsessed with soccer all the time. So that's my little spiel about this off season.
You reminded me of it. It's something I wanted to bring up. And so perfect kind of segue to it is that Why don't you tell us about your now notorious PowerPoint? Because I've heard that's made quite the positive splash, and I want you to be able to brag about your work.
Well, notorious implies that it's bad, Benton. So I don't want to.
Good notorious.
I don't want to.
It can be a good notorious.
It can be a good one. It's had great effect. So I know I'm a talker, so I promise this is long story short. I was approached about halfway through last season. In a couple of different ways, Austin Buchanan, Kim Bjorkegren, both, we talked about it and said, how can we get, these presentations to move to the next level, for prospective signings? So that's how it started. What eventually it became is we now have a welcome guide for players who we have signed. I was on a call with Ryan Dell and Caitlin Flores and Jordan Baggett today, walking her through everything. That's what you've heard Carson Pickett and Abby Erceg talk about and Paige Monahan. We walk them through names and faces to know all these little things that we built so that they know restaurants, they know coffee shops, they know where to go get their groceries, they know where to go shopping, they know the neighborhoods, they know how to pronounce Louisville. That was something that I put in Jordan's thing today because she was worried that she wasn't going to pronounce it correctly. So we put all of those things together into one PowerPoint. So they're feeling like they know the city before they get here. For prospective signings, obviously there's a little bit more to do with like training, the training facility, what their day looks like. And obviously there's tactical stuff in there too that I just build the slides. I don't say anything, which is probably for the best. But anyway, so yeah, we put those all together and the goal appears to have reached, which is to make our players feel like they know what they're getting into when they're coming here and get them excited to move to Louisville. Because I think the three of us would probably agree that this is a pretty cool city. And I don't think a lot of people realize how fun it is and how many things that there are to do here, places there are to eat, places there are to get coffee, drinks, whatever. So I'm very proud of that presentation, but it is ever evolving. I've got to add a few more places to it.
It's such an easy win to get, like getting all this stuff that you have like compiled together. So I'm really glad that you guys have had a good resource for these players. You know, making moves like this is scary. You know, they're uprooting their lives. They're going to a whole new team. There's just like a lot of newness, and that, I guess, really has to help the settling portion. So good on you all for getting that together.
I think the city is an underrated recruiting tool for the team. I feel you hear a lot of people online, they're like, everybody will want to play for the California teams because everybody wants to live in California. But I think people underrate, like, Louisville's a cool town. People that come here like it and want to stay. And I think the city is like an asset for us in recruiting players.
Yeah. Well, you have to remember, look, I mean, if there's 12 teams and there's 26 roster spots, that's a lot of people. I'm not going to even attempt to do my math here, but you're talking about hundreds of people, and that statistically, the percentage is that a certain number of them, yes, will want to go to Los Angeles or San Diego. And I mean, what they've done is incredible. So props to both of those teams. But there's going to be people who want to be in a very different type of community. And I mean, it is just such a contrast when you go to Angel City and then you come back to Louisville, just how different everything is. But we pride ourselves on everything's within 2 minutes, the training facility, the apartments, the stadium, still have the best facilities in the league. And we're really proud of that. We've been told that by people who have seen other places. And so we're excited to keep talking about that. The last step, guys, is we just got to consistently get people to these games. That's something that I think everyone can acknowledge, with more people to these games. I think winning will help, but we just got to keep spreading the gospel and talking to people around the city and in the region and get them to these games to support our players. Because like Zach said, I mean, this is a great city. It's a great sports city. And that would be the cherry on top to have it be super loud and a super fun place all the time.
Now, one thing I was wanting to ask you about are some of the new additions that we've made to the roster. I want to know who, like, going into the season, who was a name or two that you're excited about? And now that we've had several games played, like, who's kind of really stepped up in your mind? Like, who's anybody been like a pleasant surprise or kind of exceeded expectations in any capacity?
Man, that's tough. Because I've liked all of our additions. I think, you know, going into the off season and knowing really what the glaring needs were, I think we all knew that Racing really needed a commanding, confident center back to really kind of guide things. So Abby Erceg coming in, I know we've talked a lot about her. I just have so much respect for her. I think she is an incredible player. She's so fun to watch. She's so smooth, very calm. I guess because they're a package deal, her and Carson Pickett, I want to say, combine them as the two I was the most excited about in the offseason. What a trade that was. Love Emily Fox, and always will. Huge fan of hers, both personally and professionally. I think she's awesome and be rooting for her this summer. But for us, it was a great deal. And so I was really excited about them. And then I'm gonna throw you guys a curveball because we've already mentioned Ari, who's awesome. Ellie's awesome. I'm gonna throw you a curveball though and say that Kayla Fisher, to me, is someone who I am just amped about. She was, we don't have a huge staff. Okay. So to prepare for the draft, there's a small staff that's working on a lot of things. I had the pleasure of combing through social media accounts. So I at least knew who was going to be at least on the radar for our coaching staff. And as you guys were making fun of me back in January, I was sitting at the draft table, which was also one of the coolest things I've ever done. But I just didn't know what to expect from Kayla. And I know Kim keeps saying she moves kind of like a snake. It's true. Like there's something about the way she moves that is not typical. And I think she's going to be really, really freaking good. But just to have the confidence through four games, to try some of the stuff that she tries, like I'm excited about her. So she's been a pleasant surprise for sure.
She's been my biggest surprise too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You used that snake analogy at the town hall meeting where some of the players there, she wasn't there. Like she just like kind of went there to hang out.
And she was an attendee.
Yeah. She was an attendee and you used that. And that always stuck out. That stuck out to me. So, you know, I thought she had a good outing against Angel City. So I'm really excited to see more of her. And kind of seems like we did really well to get her where we did at the draft.
Mm-hmm. Louisville, I always call them Louisville. I don't know why. Racing has done awesome in the draft. I mean, over the years, you talk about Savannah DeMello going fourth. Are you kidding me? How she dropped to four is insane. But you obviously toss in Howell. Fox is an incredible player. I mean, Ekich. But even Kirsten Davis getting picked where she did and Kayla Fisher, I still think there's great potential for Parker Goins too. Jordan Bloomer is an excellent backup goalkeeper. So they've done really well in the draft. I know there's been some picks that haven't gone the way that Racing had hoped and Racing fans had hoped. But some of the finds in the draft have been really, really good. And the fact that Kayla Fisher dropped all the way to 16 after watching her play a couple times. I don't, same with DeMello. I'm like, how did that happen? How is that a thing?
I don't know about Kayla Fisher, but I think DeMello, didn't she drop because she was just coming off an injury?
Yeah, she had an Achilles. She didn't drop that far. She's still fourth, but
right. But I mean, I think if it wasn't for the injury, most people would have expected her gone higher. Yeah.
It was a tough draft. You've got Girma and Howell ahead of you. What a steal that was for us at four and mm-hmm. is playing like a one draft pick. I mean, she looks even better this year than she did last year, which I didn't think was going to be, I wasn't sure what level you could get to, but her movement off the ball, her aggression is next level. That's huge for us.
She got quite the engine.
Yeah, I mean, good God. The beating that she takes, like, you know, I know opposing fans get frustrated with her, but she, like, puts her body between her and the ball or between her defender and the ball. She draws a lot of fouls. She does not go down and she doesn't flop. She gets clattered. And she's, like, already got an enormous lead in fouls won again this year after winning by 20-something last year. But she's just impossible to defend. And I'm hoping that nobody on the national team notices for like three more months so that we can get through this season and then we'll get her as a regular. I'm kidding. Obviously I want her to have the best experience she can possibly have, but yeah, she's incredible.
Her and Katie Lund to me feel like destined for the national team, more like a win than if sort situation. I'm upset that Katie Lund hasn't got any sort of like call up to like a camp, like a vote approval, kind of like what Josh Widener kind of got. Maybe not one where they're not going to be a regular, but one saying kind of like, you're doing the right thing, kid, you know?
I would think after the World Cup, I think you'll see Lund, Howell, and DeMello all get call ups. It just depends. If they win, they'll do their little goodbye tour with all of the players who are probably going to retire. And maybe the camp is a little bit later. But if things don't go well, and obviously I'm hoping that they do go well, but if they don't go well, I would expect to see all three of them very quickly given a look and a chance to play. Because I know only Jalen has caps. So, but yeah, that's a big boost for us too. And, you know, I'm excited to see how they keep developing.
We mentioned her when we were recapping the game a little bit, but do you want to talk a little bit about I think it was just announced today, the trade for Jordan Baggett. I think Racing gave up two draft picks. One of those is conditional, as a 2024 second round and a 2025 conditional third round pick to the Spirit for Baggett. I think she was drafted out of Stanford in 2019. She's mm-hmm. been in the league a couple years. I was looking at her game logs. I think she's had some, but it looks like she's played a lot in chunks and had some chunks away. But I think in the press release, you guys mentioned that she'll be a big help during the World Cup because we're going to have a couple of midfielders gone for that stretch. Do you have anything you want to mention about her?
Yeah. I mean, I just think, you know, in the same vein, Paige Monahan has been like the best human being to add to our locker room. It's just awesome. She came up with Go Big Perp and is a huge influence in the locker room already. And we've been told that Jordan Baggett is same personality, very similar, just really bright, friendly person who will get people pumped up and going. She can play six and eight and get some depth there. And look, I think just this past couple months to see when Jalen got hurt, to see how the lineup had to shift a little bit. I think the staff realized, hey, you know, we've got the roster space. We need to go find a little bit more depth in those areas. And then, like you mentioned, Zach, with Ari Borges going off to the World Cup and who knows who else in the midfield, Wang Shuang will be going. So there's some good players who are going to be gone.
Chidiak will be gone probably.
Yeah, Chidiak will be gone too. Yeah, thank you for mentioning that. So, yeah, I mean, for Jordan to come in at her best is a really, really good player. She had a bad concussion and a hip injury that have kind of slowed down her participation. But at her best, I mean, she was an All-American in college. She was the number three overall pick in the draft in 2019. And all of the people who I trust in our building, who are big soccer people, for them to all come up to me today and say, wow, that's a good trade. That's awesome. Got me pretty excited. So I know our players are excited and I think it's a big addition.
Now, Jeff, I'm going to put you on the spot with this one. Real point blank. Is this team a playoff team this season? Did they make it? Yes or no?
Yes.
Oh, you were quick with that one.
Yeah.
I like that confidence.
I've thought that since the second day I saw them in training. So yes, they're a playoff team. We'll make the playoffs.
I agree.
I knew you were optimistic on going this season. I didn't know if anything had changed there few games in, but I didn't think there's enough evidence against that personally, but.
Yeah, I mean, I hope I'm not wrong. I mean, obviously, I think we all hope I'm not wrong. But no, I'm very bullish. I've lost some credibility because I was bullish last year and things didn't go very well. So it is what it is. But I'm very bullish on this team. I think they've got some great pieces. And if all goes to plan, things will get even better here over the next couple months when the transfer window opens up and things get going.
And I think the schedule is pretty front loaded mm-hmm. for them. And so I do think like they're really going through the tough stretch of the season already this early. So I think that could work out into their favor. Like as the team really hopefully starts to come together and click, they're also going to be in a more favorable portion of the schedule. So I think they are set up to be able to finish the season very strong.
Yeah. And I was going to say to your defense, Jeff, like this year, like I think there's a lot, like personally, I think there's a lot of evidence to suggest that this team has really like leveled up. And what you were saying, Zach, like, yeah, the more this team's going to get the gel, I think the more likely we are to start getting these results, especially with it being as front loaded as it is. So I'm still keeping the faith, still keeping my fingers crossed.
May is a huge month for racing. They got to get some wins and they got to get rolling, but it's a big month and I'm hopeful that those results will match what we're seeing so far.
Excellent.
Zach, did you have anything else that you want to ask Jeff while we have him here?
Jeff, did you have anything you wanted to plug while you're on? Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Geez. I got my AFC Richmond sweatshirt on. I don't know if you guys noticed that.
I was actually looking at it. I saw it kind of bobbing up and down in the picture. I'm like, I think that's Richmond.
Yeah. No, look, I mean, I think I say this every time I get a chance to talk about racing. I absolutely love what Louisville City has become. I remember going out on Market Street and walking over and getting, you know, a $5 ticket or whatever and hanging out at ATG after or before and having a great time and what that has built. I would love to see all those faces at racing games. I want to see crowds get to be where they deserve to be and be awesome because we know how fun it is for Louisville City games. Let's replicate that. So I want to push that
stadium is so fun when there's over 10,000 people there.
Tell me about it.
I want that for racing so bad.
Yeah.
I think if we can get a little bit of a win streak
going
this season, that will come. I think if the team is able to roll off a couple wins in a row, I think it'll really build momentum attendance wise.
Yeah. So I'll push that. And one other thing, guys, I'll just throw out real quick that I'm really excited about. We've got a bunch of opportunities coming up for people to bid on the signed barrel heads and barrel staves that we're doing at the player walk-ins. We'll have another one on Saturday. Our players signed a branded bourbon barrel stave. And we're going to auction that off. We are not getting any money for it. The club will not make any money. There's no admin fees, none of that. It's 100% of the proceeds will go to a Racing Academy scholarship. And so I'm really excited about that. Our players are super pumped about that. They really have been talking a lot. I got a lot of feedback from them in the off season that I solicited about working closely with the Academy and helping the young players come up. And so if people want to go bid on those things, they'll be going up after this weekend. And I know people, it's hard to part with your hard earned money. So we want to make it kind of a cool, unique thing. But that money will go a long way to help kids pay for travel, food, all sorts of stuff that we all know really gets pretty expensive when you're trying to go on the road. And I don't want there to ever be a barrier for kids who maybe don't come from families that can afford to travel as much as some of us can. And so I think this is a great opportunity to help. I know the foundation does a lot with scholarships too. So we're doing some great work there, but our players really want this to be kind of like a player funded scholarship from the auctioning of those items. So keep a lookout for that on our social media.
I like that. There's always a lot of like charitable efforts going on, a lot of like the signed barrel staves you're talking about, like the signed kits, like after like pride nights and stuff like that. Really, really cool. I'm really big into the charity side of things. So glad that's continuing.
For sure. Yeah. We're going to keep going.
Cool. Well, Jeff, thank you so much for spending some time and chatting with us. I know you live a busy life at work and at home. So we really do appreciate you making the time and, hoping that racing gets a few more wins under their belt soon and hope to see you in person again soon. It's been a while.
For you guys, I'd give you 2 hours. I love you guys. Thanks for having me on. I always listen to the podcast, so I'm happy to be on here. I'm probably going to hate hearing my voice.
I hate it every week. So.
I will see you guys very soon, I'm sure, and thanks for having me.
Well, thanks again, and thank you, listener, for tuning in. Hope you enjoyed yourself, and hopefully when we come back, we'll be talking about several wins. 2 for Louisville City, win for Racing. How about it?
9 points total. We got 3 opportunities for wins this week.
Let's go for it. Anyway, I've been Benton.
I'm Zach.
And we will catch you guys next week. Thomas Morados.
Bye.